Our lesson for this session is about soul making, appropriation, and improvisation. So let's define after this lesson what appropriation is, what borrowing is, and how ownership is distinct from these other two terms. Okay? So, what is soul making? First of all, it's primarily based on drawing out or depicting experiences and practices in an individual and transforming these into images, either into a painting, a sculpture, a composition, a production, or whatever art form that the artist wants to make or create. Furthermore, soul making is an exploration, you know, an application of the imagination in an active way. We use our imagination or an inspiration that we get from our environment or from other, perhaps, social media platforms like Pinterest, Google, or whatever it is that where we draw an inspiration from to connect to our soul and make what we have in mind tangible. You know, but imaginations will stay intangible until the artist converts said thoughts into form. And here we will discuss some categories of soul making. One is crafting images. Imaging or representing in any form, such as in painting, drawing, and sculpting. When you craft an image, it's not out of nothing. No, it's always out of your own thoughts or ideas, right? And it's deeply rooted in our own personal experiences, our personal encounters or events that triggered our reflection, recall, and judgment. So that is where we draw out an inspiration. So personal, it could be from your experience, or it could be out of your very own creativity, your own imagination. Another category in soul making is crafting stories. So the moment we write, inscribe, and engrave our ideas, thoughts, criticisms, commentaries, positive or negative emotions, we are crafting stories. And stories can be presented in any form, like an image, it could be film, or animations, or words, objects, or musical compositions. These stories that we craft are sacred and important in a particular time and moment. It's our own history which we can pass on to our children and family in the next generations. Then in other categories, crafting instruments. So here in this slide, we have a soul maker, a local Filipino soul maker. His name is Noy Narciso. Noy Narciso is a local artist and art professor from Davao City, who creates musical instruments through any upcycled materials and objects that he can find which are no longer in use. He is one of the very distinguished local artists, or to be specific, soul makers in the Philippines. So you can check him out on YouTube. I think he has his own channel. Yeah, again, the name of the guy is Noy Narciso, who brings life to every trash and converts them into musical instruments. Then another category in soul making is crafting movements. So here in this slide, in the first picture on your left, is a group of ballerinas, you know, and then on the right, this is more of a contemporary dance platform. She is a celebrity on TikTok. Her name is Niana Guerrero. And actually, she has two more siblings who also are like her. Dance choreographers on TikTok. So she is also an artist with a great following. So everything we do in life is a performance. At times, we need to pause to capture the movements of our energy and the world. And then another category for soul making is crafting techniques, because, you know, not all of us know how to dance, how to sing, or how to upcycle materials, but there are those whose strength is in crafting techniques. Okay, so before that, what is mindfulness? According to the dictionary definition, it's a mental state achieved by focusing one's awareness on the present moment while calmly acknowledging and accepting one's feelings, thoughts, and bodily sensations, used as a therapeutic technique. Now, but why stop there? Why not extend our mindfulness state to expressing our imagination, inspiration, or creativity? So that's where a relaxing hobby like crafting comes in, you know? So why is switching off so important? What is the role of switching off towards creativity? How does it lead to creativity? So allowing your mind to enter a playful state, as it does when creating and crafting, is essential to our general well-being. Always remaining in a state of high alert, as we can do in our day-to-day lives, doesn't allow our minds and bodies the opportunity to slow down, pause, and catch up. The key to looking after your mental health is being in the moment. So that's the secret. Being in the moment. You're celebrating each moment, being really in it. Becoming engrossed in a crafting activity draws the mind away from life's problems and busies it with creativity, imagination, fun. You know? It awakens the senses, something that can only happen in the present moment. You can never enjoy the present moment if you would not do it proactively. So you have to decide. You know? You have to decide to be in the moment. To not think of anything else but what you are doing. So crafting enables us to enter a mindful state without having to focus on doing so. We merely enjoy the experience, and mindfulness comes as a bonus. And here in this slide is how to think like Leonardo da Vinci, capturing the essence of Leonardo's genius by Michael Gelb. So there are 7 steps. So curiosity, demonstración, sensación, sumato, arte or scienza, corporalidad, and corazón. Okay? So this is just a complementary reference for you. And then, so we're done with soul making. Now we move on to what appropriation is all about. So in art and art history, appropriation refers to the practice of artists using pre-existing objects or images in their art with little transformation of the original. So one very famous Italian artist, Salvador Dali, Spanish surrealist artist who is renowned for his technical skill, precise craftsmanship, and the striking and bizarre images in his work. So that's what he said about appropriation. And some of these works are as shown. So he is a surrealist. It's an ownership and appropriation in relation to art. Okay, so copyright. It generally pertains to the general right of a person or an individual to control an object purchased or in his possession. So the copyright laws give the owner of the copyright the exclusive rights to reproduce, to display publicly, to make and distribute copies, and to prepare derivative works based on the original artwork. Thus, the purchase of a created work will merely result in the transfer of ownership, but the copyright still remains with the creator, of course, the one who created the artwork or the masterpiece, or in the case of a book, the author. So, question, how about for those works where the buyer paid for the work to be done by the artist or creator? Who will retain the copyright of the finished art piece? So that's for you to answer. I leave that to you. Right, so appropriation. Is it stealing another's artwork? Before we answer that, let me just explain this. So appropriation is using another's artwork in the artist's new context, okay? Remember that. So in appropriation, therefore, the artist does not seek to deceive the viewers of the new art piece, for there is no prohibition to bring the original message and intention of the original artwork. Rather, it's merely establishing the original art piece in a new light or context. So that's it. So going back to the question, is it stealing another's artwork? Appropriation. Now you know the answer. All right, so two ways to appropriate art. So first is by its artistic content. And then there are three artistic elements here. First, the motive, then the genre, and then the style. So in this slide, in this way of appropriating art, I specifically have these examples. So particularly focusing on this very famous artwork, The Scream, by the Norwegian artist Edvard Munch, entitled, Scream. And then, as you can see on the upper right, image. On the left is the original art piece, The Scream, and then beside it is the appropriated artwork. So the original man on the screen was replaced by a cartoon character, a very famous cartoon character. So that's an example of how you can appropriate art using the artistic content. And then below, in the image below, you can see that it's a hodgepodge of three very famous paintings. The Scream, the girl with the pearl earring, and then the Mona Lisa. So it's who is holding the phone and who took the groovy. And then the girl with the pearl earring was doing a peace sign, but in the original artwork, no, she isn't. So, and then the Scream just being how he is in the original artwork. Okay, so that's another example of artistic content appropriation. And then the second way of appropriating an artwork is by cultural appropriation. And yes, there are three ways in how you can do it. So first is by its object, second is by its content, and the third is by appropriating the subject. All right. So in object appropriation, when and how does this happen? So this happens when a tangible artwork, okay, remember that is a very technical term, tangible artwork previously owned by people from one culture was taken and adopted by a person or a group of people from another culture. So one very typical example for this object's appropriation is the totem pole, which originally was owned by the North Americans, and it was taken and adopted by the Europeans. And now it's displayed in one of the museums in Europe. Okay. And then we also have the content appropriation under the cultural appropriation. So what is it? It refers to the adoption of works of art that are intangible. So in the object appropriation, the artwork there is tangible. Here in the content appropriation, the artwork is intangible. Examples are short stories, poetry, and musical compositions. So I have two examples here. First is Salbakuta's Stupid Love. The original song was Evergreen, entitled Evergreen. And if you want to hear it, yeah, Westlife also has a rendition, a very beautiful rendition of the song, Evergreen. So, and then another is a mashup song of Mariah Carey's All I Want for Christmas Is You and My Chemical Romance's Welcome to the Black Parade. Okay, so those are examples of the content appropriation. And another is one of the favorite bedtime stories for kids entitled The Little Prince. Yeah. What is important is invisible in the naked eyes of a human being. Yeah. It was put into a very different light when recently a film was made out of it, out of the story, the Little Prince story, but it was put in a very social, political context. And from being a very favorite bedtime story for kids, now it was put into light in such a way that it has now become a story for adults to ponder upon. Okay, so it has become, because it was now put into a political light or context. So that is another example of content appropriation. And then the subject appropriation. So when does this happen? It occurs when a subject matter from another culture is appropriated. And one very, very controversial example for that, if I may say, is in the animated film Moana, the character of Maui is not a fictional character, but a Polynesian cultural hero with both human and godly characteristics. In other words, a demigod. So there are numerous views of particular origins and feats of Maui, but it's generally agreed that he is a figure of dignity, strength, and intelligence. However, the Maui in the Disney trailer appears to be frivolous, vain, and humorous. So it's very, if not opposite, very far from the demigod, Polynesian demigod, who is known for his magnitude. Because in the Disney film Moana, Maui is the comic relief of such animated film. So that's why it is very controversial. And it has raised brows of many. Okay, so moving forward, we have improvisation. So what it is? What is it? What is improvisation? It's the art and act of improvising or of composing, uttering, executing, or arranging anything without previous planning or preparation. It's producing something from whatever material or resources that are available to you. So in performing arts, it's a very spontaneous performance without specific or scripted preparation. For example, in music, composing a song impromptu or an impromptu solo performance during a concert is one example. And then in theater, a stage actor may play dramatic scenes without any pre-written dialogue, like an ad-lib, whenever a co-actor forgets his or her line. So to save face. Okay, so those are but some of examples. You may have some of your own too. So I hope you enjoyed our lesson for this video.